Welcome you all back to VTUE Sikshana program. Today, let us look at the fourth lecture of module 1. As you all know, we are dealing with 18EC63 Microwaves and Antennas course. And myself, Dr. Sri Lakshmi from RV College of Engineering is dealing with module 1. And today, let us look at lecture 4. Fine? So far in lecture 1 and 2, we saw the microwave tubes, their limitations, and what are the refinements we have to do to bring the tubes to work at microwave frequencies. And then in the second portion, we have seen what are the various microwave frequency bands, what are their applications, and what are the special properties of microwaves. Fine. Now in this lecture and in the next following lecture, let us look at transmission lines. See, you all know that when I showed you in lecture 3 the basic communication system block diagram, I showed you one block which was called as transmission media. Okay, this is the medium between the transmitter and receiver, which are the two basic blocks of communication system, whether it is a microwave system or a wireless communications, any system for that matter will have a transmitter and receiver separated by a transmission medium. Okay, this medium can be a wired medium or a wireless medium. Okay, if it is a wired medium, then we have transmission lines connecting the transmitter and receiver. Okay, so there are many types of transmission lines. The simplest example that we can take of a very basic system, which is a wired system, is our landline telephone system. So, you know that the transmitter and receiver are connected all through, how much ever far off they may be, through a two-wire cable. Okay. I hope all of you must have seen the two-wire twisted pair cable which connects your landline instrument to the pole outside and from there on to the telephone exchange and from the telephone exchange to the receiver at the other end. Okay, all through this, these systems are connected by means of a two-wire cable. This is a basic transmission line. Okay, the other wired system is your cable television network. Okay, so from the cable operator's system onto your receiver system, we have a coaxial cable running. Okay, you must have seen the cables running all above your buildings and then coming through your windows onto your receiver set. Okay, so this is different from a landline telephone cable. So I think every house will have both the cables. Today itself you can go home and check. Okay, what is the difference? Okay, so if you touch and feel the telephone cable, you feel that there are two wires, okay, separated by a small distance. And the distance is filled by a dielectric. Usually it will be a paper or some kind of a other dielectric. But in the case of a coaxial cable, that is a television cable, it is much harder when compared to the landline telephone cable. And then it has only, if you cut open the cable, you will see that there is a center conductor and also a outer conductor. And a rubber sheath which is covering both these conductors, which is black in color, is what we see on the outside. So these two conductors, this is also a two conductor line, but it is coaxial, means both the conductors have the same axis. In the other case, that is a telephone cable, both the conductors are running parallel to each other with a distance separating them, and this distance is kept same all through the cable. That is why it is hard pressed. Okay, if you see the entire cable, you will see that it is of a same dimension all through, and the two wires are separated by a common distance all through the line. Okay, and the next type of wires are the transmission media or the waveguides. Okay, so this I am telling you in the increasing order of the bandwidth or the frequency that is supported by the cables. Telephone cable supports frequencies in the kilohertz range. Coaxial cable supports frequencies in the lower megahertz range. And waveguides support microwave frequencies. But it is difficult to run waveguides for kilometers of distances. They are used up to the transmitting antenna from the transmitter setup, which is there housed inside the building, and the transmitting antenna is laid on the rooftop. Okay, from there to there, I think you have a waveguide setup. From there onwards, it is all wireless propagation. Okay, so the next type of transmission media will be the Earth's atmosphere. That will be for the wireless propagation. So now we cannot include all in the same module. So we have included only one sample transmission line structure. Okay, whatever basically we study for this transmission line, it almost applies to all the wired cables. Okay, except for waveguides. Waveguides we have to deal it in a totally different way. Okay, so now whatever transmission line equations and solutions that I am going to discuss in this lecture applies to a low frequency transmission cable, either the two wire telephone cable or the coaxial line. Fine. So let us move on. So the material for this lecture is all taken from the Microwave Devices and Circuits by Samuel Leo, the textbook 2, as per your syllabus. And we are here in the second portion of the module 1, wherein we have transmission line equations and solutions, reflection coefficient and transmission coefficient, standing wave ratio, and then standing waves. Okay, so in the following two lectures I am going to teach you these things. Okay, so let us move on. As I said before, the objectives of this lecture are to look at the transmission line equations, their solutions, what is a lossless transmission line, what is the meaning of characteristic impedance, and what is a propagation constant. Fine. So now let us move on. I hope the font is visible to all of you. So let us look at transmission line equations and solutions. Okay. So let us take a two wire line, what I was telling you in the introduction. So a two wire line will have two conductors, okay, which are separated by a finite distance. Okay. So why should we study transmission line equations? Why should we solve them? Okay. See, to look at the functioning of any system, we need to have a model. Okay. Either we need to do a simulation model or we need to do an analytical model using some equations. Okay. So if we do an analytical mathematical model only, we will be able to design the system for our requirements, because we know on what parameters the performance of the system depends if we do a model. Okay. So that is the basic necessity to study these transmission line equations. See, for any purpose or for any communication system design, we need to do the channel design. Okay. If it is a wired channel, then we need to do the design or choice of the transmission lines needed for that particular purpose. So we are modeling the transmission line as a T network. I hope you have all studied various types of networks in your network theory and control theory, right? So we are going to model this transmission line as a T network. What is a T network? A T network will have two arms, two series arms and one parallel arm. So here, this is another version of T, that is a pi network. What is a pi network? It will have one series arm and two parallel arms. Fine. So in this, I am going to represent the distributed parameters on the line. Okay. So what is these distributed parameters? See, any line, transmission line, is a copper wire or a wire of some conducting material, right? Any conductor will have a resistance, and if there are two conducting wires, there will be a capacitance which will be there, and also there will be a conductance and the self inductance of the line. Okay, so all these parameters we cannot see if you take any copper wire or any wire. Okay, I was talking of a telephone cable. If you look at the cable, you don't see any resistance, capacitance, inductance, nothing. It is simply a wire. But when you pass current through that wire, definitely it offers some resistance. It's not a superconductor, isn't it? So the characteristics, the electrical characteristics of the line are distributed all through the line in a uniform way. That is the first assumption that we make while we solve these equations. So since we cannot measure and localize that this is the resistance on the line, this is the inductance on the line, this is the conductance, we are going to draw an equivalent circuit. Okay, an equivalent circuit is a model of the parent transmission line. So wherein we represent the resistive component as a resistance in the equivalent circuit, the inductive component as an L, the conductive component as G, the capacitive component as C, right? So on one end of this, there is a generator which is feeding the transmission line with the signal. You can consider this to be your transmitter. And on the other end, there is a load. The load can be your receiver, which is receiving the signal. See, this symbol shows that it's a very lengthy line and only a small portion is taken out of the line. And how much portion is taken? There is some delta Z meters of the line that is considered for this model. And this delta Z, as the delta operator is associated with Z, the distance parameter, it's a very, very small component. Whenever you associate delta with a parameter, it means that it's only a small portion of that parameter what we have considered, a minute portion. That is why all the parameters are multiplied by this delta Z. You see here, whenever we are representing for a unit length, it is R, the total value of R in the line multiplied by that delta Z. Okay. We are considering a small portion of the line between two points A and B, let us assume. And you are feeding with the voltage Z, T. Z is a distance parameter. T is the time parameter. You must note that the voltage and current on the line are functions of two variables. Okay, the first variable is the distance. That means at every point on the line, when you move from generator to load, the value of V changes. And it is also simultaneously a parameter dependent on time. So the time instant at which you measure the value at this point will be different when compared to another time instant, though you are standing at the same place. That means Z value is constant, but T value is varying. Even then the voltage varies. Suppose you are there at the same instant, let us say you keep T constant and move on the line, Z is varying, then also V varies. Okay, so V is a function of Z, T. So, and wherever in the equations you see, we have taken partial derivative of V. In mathematics, you would have all studied what are partial derivatives. See, whenever a function parameter is dependent on more than one independent variable, then we have to differentiate the value once with respect to one variable, keeping the other constant, and vice versa. Then only we add the components and get the total derivative. What is the derivative? It's only a variation of the parameter with respect to the independent parameters, right? So in the following equations, that is what we are doing. Now consider V of ZT is fed to this at point A, because of which there is a current resulting I of Z, T. See, I is a resultant of V, so it is also a function of Z and T. Then you have some portion of it IG going through the conductance and remaining portion going to the load I of Z plus delta Z into T. Okay, so this is Z plus delta Z into T, the V parameter across B. So now this diagram is found in the book. You can also refer to it. So let us consider a conventional two conductor transmission line with distributed parameters RLGC per unit length, okay, of the line. That is what I explained to you so far. So consider a unit length of the line, that's what I said, delta z of the line. Now come to the point wherein we are applying Kirchhoff's voltage law around this loop. Okay, you see a loop here, the pi network is in the closed loop. So I am going to apply Kirchhoff's voltage law around the loop. So what does KVL say? KVL says the summation of voltage drops around the loop is given to be 0. So instead of 0, I have what done? I have done minus VZT to be taken to the left side. So it has become plus VZ of T, and all other voltage drops I have considered to the right side. Okay. IZ into R, this is one drop. L into del G by del T, that is another drop. And this VZ of T plus this. Okay. So now you have to do some mathematics. Divide whole thing by del Z, because del Z is common to the whole of the equation. Let us remove that variable. And then let us omit this function Z comma T. So this ordered pair is coming everywhere in all the terms. So let us remove it. It is understood that all both V and I are functions of Z comma T. And then you rearrange, you get this partial derivative of the del V by del Z equal to Ri plus Ldi by dt. Okay. So it is a very simple equation and first level derivative what we are taking. Similarly, you put KCL, the current law, Kirchhoff's current law at point B in the diagram. Again, it says the sum of all currents entering or leaving a junction has to be equal. Okay. So this is the entering current and these are all the leaving currents. So I have equated them. Again, since it is at a point, so delta Z value is 0 at that point B. Then divide by delta Z, omit this, rearrange, you get this equation. Okay. Then differentiate them with respect to Z again. So you get the partial derivative. Next, similarly, you differentiate the current equation also. So we are here. So this is the first step that we do. So what is it that we did? We applied Kirchhoff's voltage law once and Kirchhoff's current law once, and then we rearranged the terms and then we got these two equations, the partial derivatives. Now since voltage and current at any point on the line is a function of both Z comma T, they can be expressed as a complex function. Okay. Any complex equation will have a real term and an imaginary term, that we all of us know. Let us not bother about the imaginary term right now. So we consider it to be a real term. Okay, that is why V of Z comma T, I am considering only the real portion and then getting this much. Similarly for I. Okay. Now these are again complex functions having magnitude and phase. See, any complex variable will have a magnitude as well as phase signal. And it can be written as this value. This is a very, very important equation which we are going to look at this all through our description of the remaining portion of this module. Okay. So VZ, voltage as a function of Z, is given by V plus e power minus gamma Z and V minus into e power. So when you see, it's an exponentially varying term. The voltage is an exponentially varying term. Current is again exponentially varying term. Okay. When you look at this, we derive lot of information from this equation 8. Okay. So we are encountering a new parameter here, which is called gamma. Right. Now what is this gamma? It is equal to alpha plus j beta. Because of the j term, you know gamma is again a complex quantity, and this is called as propagation constant. Okay. Why it is called constant? Though it is shown to be varying, see, it is constant at a given frequency. This is very, very important. See, even R, L, G and C, you know, I refer to them as distributed constants. Why did I say them as constants? They are also called primary constants of the line. Okay. And this gamma, alpha and beta and many other are secondary constants. Why secondary constants? Because given the values of R, L, G, C and frequency, we can calculate alpha, beta, gamma as well as the phase velocity and many other things. Okay? All of them are told to be constants because their value is changing with respect to frequency. At a given frequency, they are all treated to be constants. Okay? This is the second assumption that we make while we are deriving the transmission line solutions. Fine? So now, out of this, we can get to know many things regarding the behavior of the signal on the transmission line. So the first thing I said, the behavior is governed by a propagation constant. What is the meaning of propagation? Movement. Movement of the signal from source end or the generator end or to the load end. Okay. Next, you have the terms V plus, I plus, V minus, I minus. See, V plus and I plus are the magnitudes in the positive Z direction. What is positive Z direction? It is a direction from generator towards the load. Okay. From left to right. Then V minus and I minus are magnitudes of the same parameters in negative Z direction, that is from load to generator. So you must be wondering, see, we are sending the signal from the generator and we expect the signal to go and sit inside the load. Where is there a wave from load towards generator? There is. I will tell you what it is. Okay. So now we understand that there are two signals, one in the positive direction of the Z and another one in the negative direction of the Z. And of course, I told you alpha and beta are attenuation constant, which is measured in napers per unit length, and beta is phase constant, which is measured in radians per unit length. Fine. So till now what we did, we differentiated the transmission line model with respect to Z, and we have arrived at two differential equations for voltage and current, and then we have expressed it in a complex form. Fine. Next, we can also express the equations in the phasor form. See, till now we have done only with respect to Z. We forgot T, isn't it? Now suppose you substitute del by del T for JW in the previous equations, you will get this kind of an equation. Okay. So, differentiating again these, you arrive at the second derivative, which is another form of the transmission line equation. See, so far, we have only formulated the equation. We didn't solve it yet, isn't it? So, we have formulated the equation in the phasor form and also in the complex form. Fine. So in the phasor form, you see two more parameters which are new to us. Gamma we know already. Gamma is a propagation constant. V and I we know. Z we know. So there is two more terms. One is Z, capital Z and capital Y. This is small Z, the distance parameter. Capital Z. See, this capital Z is the impedance of the line. You know what is impedance, isn't it? Impedance is equal to resistance plus reactance. Please note, impedance is equal to resistance plus reactance. Okay. Reactance here is due to the inductor. So it is XL, capital X, suffix L. Okay. So, XL is equal to J omega L. This we all know from the basic circuit theory. And what is omega? Omega is the frequency parameter. It's the radian frequency, in fact. It is equal to 2 pi f. This all of us know. Okay. So, while we take up the example problem, we see how it is solved. Fine. Now, come to capital Y. See, this is admittance. What is the relation between Z and Y? impedance equal to 1 by admittance, Z equal to 1 by Y. And what is the admittance equal to? Admittance is equal to conductance plus susceptance. Okay. So, conductance is always represented by G, susceptance by capital B, B for Bangalore. Okay. So, B in this case is equal to J omega C, where C is the capacitance, omega is 2 pi F. Okay. When we take up the Smith chart and impedance matching, I am going to tell you more about the impedance, reactance, susceptance, conductance and many of these things. Fine. I am going to also give you the equations for them. Right now, you please understand capital Z is impedance and capital Y is admittance. Impedance is measured in ohms per unit length. Admittance is measured in mhos per unit length. Okay. Actually, mho is not, mho is not a SI unit. Okay. Siemens is the SI unit for admittance. Okay. Then, how are they related to gamma? Gamma can be calculated as square root ZY. Okay. Which will be equal to alpha plus J beta. So far, what did we do? We formulated the transmission line equations and then we have looked at all these new terms. Fine. So, next what we have to do, we should also do understand what is a lossless transmission line. What is a lossy transmission line? So far, whatever we discussed, no, that's a lossy transmission line. Why you tell me? Because it has a resistance character and also a conductance. See, whenever there is a resistance, there will be always voltage drop across the resistance, which will account for the losses, resistive losses. So, it's a loss transmission line, lossy transmission line. In a lossless transmission line, you have the resistance equal to conductance equal to zero. Okay. Is it then a superconductor? If there is no resistance, then it has to be a superconductor, isn't it? No. This is only our assumption for the mathematical purposes. No conductor has resistance equal to zero. Okay. See, in the previous expression, we saw in the impedance Z equal to R plus J omega L, isn't it? See, as the frequency goes on increasing. So, where does the frequency increase? When you take up the microwave band. So, at microwave frequencies, the product of omega and L will be far greater than R, right? So, in such cases, we neglect R compared to omega L. Did you get it? So, whenever we neglect R, we consider it as equal to zero in our mathematical equation. Fine. Similarly, in the Y term, omega C will become far greater than G value. So, we neglect G when compared to omega C. So, a lossless transmission line will be basically a very high frequency line, wherein you can neglect the value of R and G. So, in the mathematical equations, if you put R equal to G equal to 0, you get these values. Fine. So, then, okay, so far what did we do? We just formulated the mathematical model of the transmission line equation. Now what we should do? We should solve it. We should solve it and get to know the dependence of the transmission line design on the various parameters. Fine. So now let us look at the solutions to the transmission line equations. Okay. So, one solution to the equations is that you can write this as a complex quantity that I have already told you. So, before we solve it, you analyze this equation, whatever we have formulated. See, I told you, we see two components on the line, is it not? So, when I showed you the equation, I said we have V plus V minus and then I plus I minus. So, what are the two components? and I also told you they are exponentially varying. Okay, you know what is the variation of exponential. Okay, so if you see the diagram below, you see V plus is exponentially decreasing because it is e power minus alpha z, and V minus is associated with e power plus alpha z, so it is exponentially increasing. You see, this is the generator end and here is the load end. Fine. So now when you look at the voltage equation from the mathematics what we have derived, we see there are two components in that. One is an exponentially reducing term with respect to z, that is with respect to distance. The other one is an exponentially growing term from the generator end if you see. But from the load end if you see, it is exponentially reducing term. Okay. Similarly to the current wave. So this wave associated with V plus is called as forward wave, and this in the minus z direction indicates the backward traveling wave. Okay. So what is the reason for this backward traveling wave? We are going to see next. Fine. So which are the two components which are there in the transmission line? One is the forward traveling wave line, other one is the backward traveling wave on the line. Fine. And incidentally, the term beta z is also called electrical length of the line. Okay. If somebody refers to the electrical length of the line, don't get confused. It is the physical length z multiplied by the phase constant beta. Fine. Now, let us move forward. So, I told you, we have two more terms which are related to the transmission line solutions. So, one such term is the characteristic impedance. Okay. What is this characteristic impedance? See, the input impedance of a line which is infinitely long. How much is infinity? See, there is no mathematical equivalent to infinity. We cannot measure, isn't it? Infinity is very great, very big. How much big, we don't know. The input impedance of such a line is called characteristic impedance. The other definition is that if you terminate or if you put characteristic impedance at the load end, then you get the input impedance equal to the characteristic impedance. This is the definition. So this characteristic impedance is a very important term which is measured in ohms, and its significance, again, I'll explain it to you when we take up the Smith chart. Okay. So this Z naught is called characteristic impedance. It is equal to root of Z by Y. What are Z and Y? We have seen before, isn't it? It is a line impedance and line admittance at a point given by R plus j omega L divided by G plus j omega C. So at microwave frequencies, what did I tell? Omega L is far greater than R, omega C is far greater than G. So both these we take it to be 0. So Z naught becomes equal to root of L by C. So look at this. For a given line, it is a constant. It is not dependent on frequency, not dependent on Z, not dependent on T. It is a constant depending on the material of the line, which decides the C and L values. Okay. That is why this parameter is very special. Okay. Next, the propagation constant. This we have already defined till here. Gamma is Z into Y. So when you substitute Z and Y values and apply binomial expansion, you get individual values for alpha and beta. Okay. Because you know gamma is alpha plus J beta. It's a complex term. So in the expansion also you have two terms. One is real, other one is complex. Equate the real term to alpha, complex term to beta. So you get this. And what are alpha and beta? Alpha is attenuation constant. Beta is phase constant. Okay. At microwave frequencies, alpha is 0. Because R and G are 0. No? So both terms vanish. So you get only alpha equal to 0. Beta is equal to W. That is omega into root LC. Fine. So this is at microwave frequencies. Incidentally, we also have another term which is called phase velocity, VP, P suffix phi. So this is the velocity with which a single frequency wave travels on the transmission line, propagates. So this can be shown to be equal to omega by beta. So omega you know, and beta is omega root LC. So when you put it, you get omega to be 1 by Vp to be 1 by root LC. So if you take for air, epsilon is epsilon naught into epsilon r, you get a constant, and mu, the permittivity is mu naught into mu r, this is a constant. So Vp will be equal to 1 by root of mu naught into epsilon naught. So you get that this is equal to 3 into 10 power 8 meters per second. And what is this? This is velocity of light in free space. So phase velocity, that means what? In free space, the signal, electromagnetic signal of any frequency travels with the speed of light. This is the first thing that I told you when we discussed electromagnetic spectrum, isn't it? So phase velocity in any other medium will be less than that. By how much? By root of mu r into epsilon r meters per second. Okay. So in a nutshell, this is what we have to see in the transmission line solutions. So we have a worked example here in the book. So if you see given the frequency, the primary parameters of the line, you can calculate Z naught and gamma, which are the secondary parameters of the line. Okay. I hope you all know how to manipulate complex numbers in your calculators. Okay. So let us see this. When I take up the Smith chart, I'll give you more information on how to use complex numbers, how to do mathematics with complex numbers. Fine. Okay. So to summarize today's lecture, so we started with the transmission line modeling using equations. So we modeled the transmission line behavior using two differential equations for voltage and current as a function of the distance parameter Z as well as time. And then we got simplest solutions, one set of solutions, which showed us that there are two components of waves on the line. One is a traveling wave in the positive Z direction. Other one is a traveling wave which is in the backward Z direction. Fine. And then we defined various terms associated with the transmission line. Z naught, characteristic impedance, gamma, the propagation constant, and their equations, and also phase velocity and their interrelationships among themselves and